and do use the chat box throughout. We'll be keeping an eye on it. So yeah, thank you all for joining today. It's going to be a fascinating session, I'm sure. So I'll hand over now to Matthew for this workshop on From Surviving to Thriving, Keeping a Special School Supported During a Global Pandemic. So over to you, Matthew.
Fabulous, thank you. And what a catchy title that was. Apologies for that. So I'm going to share my screen with you guys, if that's okay. But it's a real, it's a privilege to be with you today and just to share a little bit of information about who we are and what we've been doing and what it's meant to us and the impact it's had on our children and their families, and talk a little bit about outcomes for children, if that's okay. And I hope it really complements and cements all of the presentations we were sharing before we took our lunch. So my name's Matt and I'm the principal of St Giles School, which is I guess it's a medium-sized special school in Nottinghamshire. It's in the north of Nottinghamshire, and we have 130 pupils. About 3 years ago we had 104 pupils, and in September we've already agreed places for 148 children. So we're really proud to be growing and to be playing a really exciting part in our local school community and for the education and support of children and young people. So I just want to share with you our journey over the last very nearly 12 months. So we believe that no dreams are out of reach. And when we talk about dreams, we talk about determination, resilience, enthusiasm, aspiration, motivation and success. So in terms of everything that we hold really close to our hearts here at St Giles, they're the kind of the six key things that keep us going. And all we want to do, the only reason we exist, the only reason we come to work in the morning, is to meet all of the needs of all of our kids as best as we can. And I think what we know and what we recognise is that we might be a school and a school's function is to provide education, but we recognise that the learning breadth and the bandwidth that we operate in to support our children is really huge. And we use education, health and care plans to support, cement and guide our work here at St Giles. We've had a fair number of our children shielding, but we've been very busy. So at the height of the very first lockdown, we had probably less than 15 children attending school at any one time. And by May 2021, we had 68 children attending regularly, which was probably, I think it was treble the national average for that point in time. And we've got about, I think we've got 93 children in school today, which is great and really, really exciting. We have 88 members of staff in school across all roles. So we've got 13 classes, we've got a post 16 and a sixth form. We've got nursery elements of what we do. And around a quarter of our children have profound and multiple learning difficulties and complex medical conditions. And so I was really excited to see so many NHS colleagues joining us today. If at any time you want to throw a question or a comment into the chat, Saskia and I are going to try and keep an eye on that that conversation. Great stuff. So let me take you back. So the first 5 days, from March the 16th, I wrote a letter to our parents saying something's going to happen. We're not sure what it is, but trust us and we'll trust you to make this as good as we can for your children. And so that was our starting point. And it was a very honest and transparent letter. And our school, just so you know, about 3 years ago, it was in a really difficult place. So we had children leaving. We were on the front page of our local newspaper. We'd made the national news. And we were going through a real significant period of challenge as a school. So on the 16th of March, to have parents say, OK, we trust you, what are we going to do and how are we going to work through this? meant the world to us as a school, and also it set the absolute tone that we were in this together. We weren't really sure of what we were doing. What we knew was one day we'd be coming back to school, and we didn't know when that would be. I thought it might be the summer holidays initially. The next day we sent loads of information home to parents. So we produced packs, we sent all of our blended learning home, we sent pieces of equipment home. And then suddenly, as this kind of pandemic thing started to take hold, very quickly, so within a matter of days, we'd almost gone down to half of our children staying at home because their parents wanted to keep them safe. We worked with our social care colleagues and set up a keeping in touch system where we identified the children that we were most worried about not seeing on a day-to-day or even a weekly basis, face-to-face basis in school. So from that week, we started to visit families at home. I think the supermarkets were starting to empty with our food, so we were taking food to families' houses. And we, on the 19th of March, sent a list to the local social care team saying, these are all of the children that we're going to keep an eye on. These are the ones that are open to you and that you know about, but these are all of the other ones. And by the end of that week, we had co-produced, I think initially it was 10 principles of how we would respond to COVID together. And I'm really proud that that was co-produced with parents, staff and pupils. And we were able to describe, I think, with a degree of effectiveness, what we were going to do, how it was going to work. And we were then open every single weekday and some weekends from March the 16th right through until the end of July. And we also remained open for the first 2 weeks of the summer holiday to run a summer school for any children of key workers or any parents that just felt they needed a break, or any children that wanted to come and do something different in school. So the key principles kept us good, and it kept us well. And also they became a foundation for a document that we then produced and shared nationally, which was our operational guidance and operational response to COVID, which talked about all sorts of things like, can I bring my lunch in? Where do I park if I'm dropping my children off? How do I access the internet from home? What if we haven't got devices? Can I have my child's standing frame? How will my child see their friends? Going right through to, for the staff, which toilet should I use? Where will I eat my lunch? Will we be doing hydrotherapy? Do I have to come to work? So we did all of those things from a really early point. And what we said, that our people were our first priority, and then our families were our second priority. And it didn't matter whether that was my wife and our children, or whether it was the siblings of our students or their parents or their carers, that those were the two most important things in our world at that time, because we knew that as we came out of the pandemic, at whatever point that is, we'll still be here together, and we would still have to have functioned as a team and as a group. So we also agreed to make all of our decisions together. So I'd never been a teacher, I'd never been a head teacher, I had a really boring job working in a local authority as a head of SEN, as a team manager for SEN. And suddenly I was dealing with real life people and real life children, but what I said was, we'll do this together. And I think that made a real difference for us. We found out loads of stuff we did not know about. We found out about parents, about family functioning, dynamics, resilience. We found out about the primary and secondary needs of siblings. We found out about loads about ourselves as practitioners and the support that we needed. And we also very quickly adapted to learning inside and outside of school. So by the end of March, in the first lockdown, we'd already developed a blended learning offer. And our blended learning offer wasn't just about doing phonics and things like that. It was about pencil grip, sitting, standing, posture, position, behaviour management, attention, autism, all sorts of things, because we started to get the idea that we would be in this position for months, you know, as opposed to weeks. So we built opportunities for children to see us and hear us every single day. So we started reading nighttime stories. Parents started reading nighttime stories and developing their own literacy skills, because going back to those first two key priorities about our children and staff and our families, being connected was really important. And so we started doing things like staff quizzes, we did fancy dress competitions at home, you know, all sorts of things, all sorts of things like that, because it was just important to us. So this notion of getting through very quickly transformed into thriving. We didn't just want to get through the pandemic. We wanted to do it in style, and we wanted our parents to be able to really get the hang of it. And I think, as I reflect today, in terms of being February 2021, I don't think our school community has ever felt as strong as it feels today. I think the sense of honesty and transparency between us is phenomenal, and it's been a game changer. And I just want to give you a couple of examples, if that's okay with you. I get nervous when I hear about catching up and loss and recovery. I get it and I agree with it. But the foundation of that is based on a significant number of assumptions that might not be right. So we have a young man at our school, and ever since I joined the school a couple of years ago, he'd had a really difficult transition from a mainstream school to a special school. In his mainstream school, he was attending school for about half an hour a week. And when he came to our school, he attended every day, but he might be in the corridor or under a table or displaying behaviours that challenged. He liked to set the fire alarm off. He loved the kind of the routine and the predictability about what happens when you do press that red button on the side of the wall. And we were really worried about how he would come back to school after lockdown. And we thought, you know, will we ever get him back? And do you know, he made more progress in lockdown at home, in the safety of his own home, working with his incredible mum. And so he made about six times the amount of progress in from February, March to July than he'd made in the last 12 months in school. When he came back to school in September, he went into a classroom and he works from, this doesn't sound glamorous, but he works from a cupboard with the door open at the back of the room in a really safe, controllable scenario, and he's holding a pencil, he's writing, he's complying, he's engaging, he's doing exceptionally well. So when we think about thriving, we have to remember how well lots of these children will have done at home. And yes, it would have been difficult, but we had to put those tools and skills in place. So we trained mum and supported mum around PDA. For children with complex health conditions, we understood very quickly that what they needed was probably more about equipment, coaching, and kind of support with therapies. And whether that's therapies with a big or a little T, doesn't really matter. So on the first week of the lockdown, we hired a van, a lorry, and any child who needed a standing frame or their wedges or any splints or therapy equipment or slope tables, anything they needed we had in school, we took it home. Because actually we recognised they wouldn't be able to thrive, and some of them might not survive if their posture wasn't right and if they weren't getting the right levels of support. So we enacted that reasonably quickly, and we engaged with, and we are very lucky, we have a great team of practitioners who are very busy and kind of have been reorganised and things like that. But the pandemic gave us permission to forget about that, because what we actually said was, what are we going to do now for these children? So being able to link into Terry, who's our DCO, to link in with nursing managers, therapy team managers, and to have those in the round conversations. So it was every Wednesday afternoon, we have a little bit of a case discussion after an initial assessment of who was in, who was out, and who needed what. We then could say, for any child, this was their physio need, this was their SALT need, this was their OT need, this was their education need, this is some of their social needs. And we built those plans and we shared the load with colleagues across that whole multidisciplinary landscape, which felt really good. And one of the things I hope we will never lose was that permission to create new and slightly different or amended, tweaked ways of working, because I think it's made a huge difference to our children. We were also really fortunate, because I realised pretty quickly that we probably wouldn't have, we weren't going to spend all of the money we thought we were going to spend that year on the things we thought we were going to spend it on. So we earmarked £100,000, and we then, once we knew the gaps, we then commissioned some of the things we thought we might need for our children. So we commissioned some occupational therapy, sensory integration support from a private company. We had some social care consultancy. We're still working with an education, health and care plan specialist to help us get to the bottom of having great outcomes for kids, and our adults as well. And so we were able to redirect that money to help us to help the children to thrive, which was really great. We offer art therapy, drama therapy and music therapy in school and in a blended way at home for parents, which has gone down really well. And we've also opened our own counselling service for parents to support them with their resilience and to give them space to think. So we commissioned 6 sessions for any family who want it to talk about anything they want to talk about, to help them to continue to meet the needs of their children as best as they can. So that was how we started to turn the tide. We also told parents how amazing they were. I've seen it from a local authority perspective in the past, but I've never felt it in the way I feel it here. And I felt it through the pandemic. I think parents do an outstanding job at parenting and caring for and being that ultimate care professional and care lead for their child, as well as being their biggest advocate, their biggest love, their biggest support, their biggest crutch, you know, all of those things. But actually, they worked tirelessly. And now I think we understand what parents were going through. And they understand what we did at school. You know, we were able to lift the lid on this idea that I wonder what my kid does when they get on the bus at 7:45 in the morning, and when they get home at 4:45 at night, or whatever, you know, 5:00 at night. We showed them into classrooms. We gave them tutorials online. We opened a Facebook page. We had drop-in sessions. We opened a parent bar. We did bingo. We did quizzes, because actually we needed to continually celebrate their great work, and we tackled the challenges together. So, if it's all right with you, I'm going to take a breath, because I appreciate all I've done is just babble at you, and it's been really non-interactive. I just want to share with you a video, and I just want you don't have to type anything into the chat if you don't want to, but just have a look perhaps at some of these outcomes that parents were supporting their children to achieve while they were at home. So I'm going to just share with you. Oh, switch speakers to include audio. Oh my gosh. Sorry, everybody. I'm going to do this. I think you should be able to hear it, but let's see how we go. So hopefully you can see our little school logo and it says the curriculum at home. Here's what our students were doing.
Clouds, whoa, oh.
So, wow. I don't know how to let me do that. There you go. So, hopefully that just gave you a bit of an idea of kind of some of the things that we did. So where you can see tough spots, you know, the big pink table that was elevated from the floor, and we bought those and we sent them home for families. The trike that you saw Charlie riding was one that we lent over to him. And it was just spectacular. So we I think we managed to kind of achieve the kind of the things that we wanted to achieve. We also spent some time visiting some of our children who were in hospital, some of our children who were in residential care, and we had to create really innovative solutions to being able to visit those places and to provide the children with the support. And I will say that one of our acute trusts, one of our hospitals in Nottinghamshire, just went so above and beyond in what must have been one of the most challenging times that they've probably ever been through, about having one of our children staying with them, you know, in on the children's ward. And what we did a beautiful project to upskill their play workers and their, because the hospital school wasn't engaging at that point, so it was just their play teams in the height of the pandemic. So we went in and we ran sessions, and we also blended learning into the hospital. So we're now really confident that, you know, whether a child is receiving therapy or whether they are very poorly, that we can still have a presence with them and around them, even if it's not physical, during their care or any admission. And so I think that was just an aside that just came to me, so I hope you don't mind me sharing that. And I suppose what I just want to share with you, I wrote this presentation back in January for something I was doing with Christine and CDC at the time, but just to give you an idea that if you remember over Christmas, the Department for Education announced that there'd be some changes and bits and pieces on our return to school. So we were never nervous to take the time that we needed to take to plan whatever our next step was going to be. And we always tried to think about what the third step away from the step we were just planning might have been, or what it may have looked like or have felt like. So we then, in a day, designed and delivered a testing centre, which was in our school hall initially. It's now moved into our science lab. And in that first week, we conducted 226 lateral flow tests. We tested 100% of our staff, and we'd also done some work around how we supported our pupils to think about having a lateral flow test so they could make an informed choice. We also got into huge debates around consent around capacity and around all sorts of ideas, and we were able to write videos, write social stories, write videos, be descriptive, and also feed into some of that national work around that testing program, which was really exciting. So very suddenly, you know, in this new national lockdown, we had 2/3 of our children in school. You know, we had 82 learners in that first full week back. And as I say, we're just under the 100 mark now, with all bar, I think, 9 children who are clinically extremely vulnerable and who will shield until the end of March. All bar 9 of our children will be back. So there you go. That's just a little bit really about our story. And I think the things I'll hold on to are, I don't think we're going to go back. I don't think we're going to, you know, reopen on whatever day things look and feel like they might have used to have felt, and do things that we used to do. I think we've learned too much. We've developed flight paths around every child's outcome in every annual education, health and care plan. We're better embedded than we've ever been with the local health service. We've created new strategic groups in Nottinghamshire. So there's a social care and disability forum that meet twice a week to discuss the most complex cases, and I represent education on that. Special school head teachers, we met virtually or remotely every single day in the beginning of the pandemic, so that we were consistent, so that whatever we were doing with our 130 students and all of their families and all of our staff, you were more likely to have received an equitable offer. So we made a decision very quickly across the 11 special schools locally that we would be open for any child who needed us, or any child we thought needed us, as much as they needed us to be open. And we would look at providing learning in the home, linking in with short breaks providers. And I think one of the really exciting developments is that we'll probably look at how we provide short breaks over the weekend and into evenings, not residentially, to continue to support. Because as we move forward, I think there's going to be a lot of demand on a lot of services, and we can predict and project that a little bit. So we're going to keep sharing our story with anybody who will listen to us. So I'm so sorry. You've been borne the brunt of that this afternoon. We've redefined the roles of parents in school. Parents, our children have always been at the heart of everything that we do. But my God, we'd have been nothing. We'd have been an absolute mess without the support of parents and carers through this pandemic. And I believe that, and I don't think we'll ever be able to repay parents for everything they've done and everything they've been for their children in over the last 12 months. And we hope to use our experience to shape and influence and improve the experiences for children and young people. And one of the things I was doing before I hopped into this second session was we're looking at restructuring our school. And one of the things that we think we will do is we'll have a head of health and wellbeing, we'll have a head of futures and outcomes, and we'll have a head of education. And we will employ our own social worker to be the expert on social care provision, and we'll employ our own qualified health practitioner to lead and champion our work on improving outcomes for children and their health. So all of the stuff we were hearing about this morning, I think now's the time, you know, build back better, as some may say, but now's the time to keep taking the brave steps, because we have really learned over the last 12 months that no dreams are out of reach, genuinely. And we can do things so, so differently. And I think it would be a grave mistake to go back to how we used to do things. We need to use this to inform the SEN review. We need to use this to inform the higher needs block funding review. We need to use this to inform NHS England's plans on improvement and on services for children and young people with learning disabilities, with special educational needs, life-limiting conditions. And we need to draw all of those things together, because I think schools could be a little bit of glue. And I think that where things have worked well over the last 12 months, we're probably a really strong influencer over parents, carers and our children. So there you go. I'm going to pause and I'm going to stop, because that is the end of how we've gone from surviving to thriving at St Giles.
Oh, thank you so much, Matt, for a really inspiring session. There's so much important learning there. And as you can probably see now, you've stopped sharing a lot of love in the chat for the wonderful video you shared and for the whole presentation, really. So just with the 5 to 10 minutes we have left in the session, I was wondering if there are any questions or any reflections that anyone wants to ask. Either post a comment in the chat or feel free just to unmute and ask directly. I can see there's lots of typing. Michelle, were you going to say something?
Yeah, Matthew, I just wondered if you'd be able to share some of the ways that you engaged the pupils in consenting or understanding consent for the lateral flow test, because that's a big issue moving forward.
Brilliant. And I think it is, and I think looking at how we move to home testing as well in SEM, we spoke to some of our students about that this week and parents, and I think the consensus here is for any child who was doing those LFTs in school, they want to continue doing them in school because we built the routine. But how did we get consent? So we looked at all of the stuff the Department for Health and Social Care offered, and we wrote our own consent forms. It's all on our website, so whatever our website is, it's /COVID-19, but if you Google us, we're on there. We produced a video, so we showed step-by-step video guides. We gave all of the students who were going to think about doing their testing, testing kits to look, to feel, to smell. We did some desensitization work, so I know this is beyond consent, but just around touching noses, fingers, put my own fingers in my nose, God. But you know, all of those kinds of things to try and support. We went into the room, we emptied the room, we filled the room, we kind of did the virtual tours. We've got some pretty zany headsets as well that really helped to make that real for children. So social stories, pictures, videos, symbols.
Right,
and a simplified version, and we also got their signature, so we actually said, right, this is your consent form.
Brilliant, thank you, that's really helpful.
There's a comment in the chat saying thank you, your message is very powerful and needs to be shared, and asking if you could say a bit more about how your school works with the community.
Okay, so I suppose we bulldozed our way into it, really. So I guess the role I had before I came here, I knew lots of people, so was reasonably well connected and kind of knew the movers and the shakers across health and social care, which was really helpful. And I invited myself to the local, they have head teacher groups, like area head teacher meetings. So we've got a special school one, but there's also one for my local community. So I now attend that. And this week we've just set up a send return to school forum where we'll all share our best practice, because I'm really nervous that there might be some children in mainstream settings, as well as special to some extent, but mainstream settings, that might not find the return to school very easy, or that there might be some practitioners who will be challenged by some children's return to school. And I think we need to do all we can to get on the front foot. So we're meeting again next week to kind of share that best practice and kind of keep that work driving forwards. And the other thing we did during lockdown on our school campus, we share with a mainstream secondary. The mainstream secondary was the hub for all the key worker children of all the primary schools and all the secondary schools to come to and access their learning. So we had we did like a VE Day street party. And we joined in and we kind of embedded ourselves, and we also shamelessly flirted with the local media. So we wanted to, one of my key things is it's really easy to lose visible sight of children with special needs, especially when they're locked away for a year in their bedrooms or their houses. So I wanted our kids to be seen and celebrated. So we were always talking to our local newspaper. We did lots of social media work. You know, and the guidance that we wrote for our school was downloaded 4,500 times, and you know, was used over in Northern Ireland. You know, we linked it into the Department for Education, we shared it with the Department of Health. So I think it's just about being seen and being a passionate advocate being the change makers that we all need to be in everything that we do.
Brilliant, thank you. There's probably time for one final question if anyone wants to ask.
Mine isn't a question, Saskia, but I would just like to say thank you so much, Matt, because, you know, seeing what you've done and how you work within the school with the children, young people and families, hearing some of the things we discussed nationally as well, learning from what you've experienced, we need to get this out more into the health space. So I will be sharing this video wide, if that's okay, because you mentioned you've got a great relationship with the designated clinical officers, and you know, not every designated clinical or medical officer has a great relationship with their school, and I think that's something we really want to build up and do more about in the coming months. So thank you so much, it's fantastic, you put a smile on my face.
A real pleasure, thanks Lorraine, it's kind of you.
Yeah, absolutely echo that. Do you have any final thoughts, Matt, just to end the session with?
I'll just leave you with one, if that's allowed.
Brilliant.
That's a lie. I'll leave you with two. One is, thank you for taking the time and for working so tirelessly in whatever it is that you've done to continue to shine the spotlight on children and young people with special educational needs and disabilities, because they will need us more than ever over the next 2, 3, 4 years. You know, we'll be dealing with, I would imagine, with backlogs, with waiting lists, with assessment problems, with staff shortages, you know, and look at me, I'm being very negative and we've been so positive, but there will be challenges ahead, but they're really predictable. And I think by reorganizing and reshaping, and perhaps by letting go of some of the things that we've been up until the pandemic very possessive over, I think is a really positive way to start thinking about moving forwards. If we need to meet the holistic needs of children, well, let's do it, and let's do it unashamedly. Let's fill schools and community spaces with children who need the support. Let's fill them with the professionals that need to provide that support, and let's just do it because it's the right thing to do for our kids.
Amazing, thank you. Thank you. A note to end the day on. Thank you so much, Matt, and thank you everyone for coming to this workshop and also for attending the whole conference. I've just posted a link to an evaluation form into the chat. We'd really appreciate it if you could take the time to fill it out, just to let us know how this conference has been for you, anything we could change and what you'd want future workshops to focus on. But yeah, thank you all so much for coming, and thank you, Matt. And if you're okay with it, we can share your slides to everyone that's attended the session, just so they can recap. But thank you everyone, and have a great rest of your day.
Thanks very much. Bye-bye.